tougher kind. You know how I feel. Oh, freedom is mine. And I know how I feel. It's a new dawn. It's a new day. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
Everybody knows about the Colored Girls. I mean, they're an institution in D.C.
When I first heard the Colored Girls, I thought it was very appropriate because it encapsulates so much. I mean, it is the history of, okay, these are just some colored girls. These colored girls have power and influence.
If you want to get something done in Washington, these are the people that you ought to know.
These are black women who, for many ways, have been the tip of the spear, if you will, for black people in this town for the last 20 years.
I don't think they set out to say, we're going to define the space for black women in Washington, black women in politics. They weren't trying to do that. They did that.
These are smart, accomplished women who will kick your ass.
There are four of us who all worked at the DNC at one time or another, have been involved in politics over the last 30 years, and we're still speaking to each other. So
we were at the Dukakis Benson campaign. Me and Donna were sharing an office, and we got notice that we were going to move either down or up. But the floor we were on obviously hit all the, I call them the muckety mucks. And so we had commandeered, I think it was a conference room. And somehow Donna wrote on a piece of paper, Colored Girls, we shall not be moved. And so she posted it on the door. And that's how we ended up being known as the Colored Girls.
We're just really good girlfriends. And I think we started as political, came together around politics. And most days it's like, hey, what you doing? I don't know, what you doing? But those are the friends that we've now become, where it's more social, supportive, encouraging, sister friends.
Just like anybody else, I think we have all of our arguments, and we fight with each other, then we'll take you off the email and we'll say something crazy about each other. But it's never really, really personal. And I think that's because we're so battle tested. We know what trouble is. We've had to protect enough people that's in trouble.
We have no resolution. I mean, we rarely curse each other out.
If I had to describe Mignon, I would say loyalty.
I am fiercely private. You know, when I come inside my house, it is like the only place that I feel like I know I have the peace, especially if there's nobody here to talk to but me. You know, I just feel like God has given me a tremendous capacity to take more than my share. And it's usually behind the scenes. I mean, most people don't know half the stuff I do. I've never been one that looked for fame or glory. Probably a lot of what people don't know about me is I love to have more fun than they think I'm more serious.
Okay, I want to tell you, I am missing work from the Chaya group.
If I had one word to describe Leah, it would be spiritual.
She has been a jewel. She has been the joy of my heart.
My father, he would wake us up for school in the morning. He would sing Jesus Loves Me in the morning.
Jesus loves me, this I know.
For the Bible tells me so.
Little ones to him belong.
They are weak, but he is strong. I am very committed to my faith. That is the guiding force of my life. I don't plan things because everybody here is so five-year plan and networking. I'm going to meet this person and I'm going to meet that person and then I'm going to plot my life. God and I came to an understanding and I said, my career belongs to you and I won't worry about it. I'm not going to gloss things over. It's pretty cut and dry things for me, and I have to struggle hard to dress things up and be. I've learned over my years of working in a Democratic Party how to be diplomatic.
If I had to describe Yolanda Martha Stewart in blackface, I would call her beloved.
I have a public relations agency in Washington, D.C. We represent national clients, major corporations, nonprofits, anybody who'll hire us.
Donna is mystery to me.
I doubt very seriously many people know who I really am, and that's a good thing.
Donna's lovable. She's different. Special.
Will you sit on the sofa for 3 minutes?
No, I'm cooking.
Usually when you see stories about Washington, it's all the Capitol or the White House.
Every part of the city has a heartbeat.
See, Washington is different because Washington is very profile. It's very who you know.
You can't have thin skin, that's for sure. You just have to keep pushing, you really do.
I had gotten to know them because I was running for president. And I knew them by reputation. And so when asked to come to this dinner, I said, sure. And they made it clear that they were going to interview basically the people who were running for president.
I think it started because we were being invited to another group of meetings where a couple of guys, white guys, obviously, they were inviting people to come meet the candidates. And so I think we walked out of one of those meetings and said, we should be doing this ourselves. We met with, you know, then Senator Obama. I brought him to the meeting. We met with Senator Clinton. So we had them all there.
There's not a question about whether you will respect Mignon, or you'll respect Donna, or you'll respect Leah or Yolanda. You just do.
The dedication of the Martin Luther King Memorial that took place a couple of years ago, they had gone out and hired two big majority firms to put everything together, who just didn't have a clue. There were just a lot of things that weren't done, and we kind of had to just step up and pretty much take over at one point. It was beautiful. I remember the first time I walked out on the mall and actually saw the memorial. It's just amazing, and I was really, that's one of my proudest moments.
It was the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington. So Leah and I were looking at the program. So, you know, Dr. Bernice King, she had a wonderful, great ideas, but they were all over the place. Leah put on her church program hat, and I just put on my organizing hat. We're like, okay, we got to reorganize this so it will make some sense, especially since it would, you know, most of it was gonna be live. And then we kept sitting there and saying to ourselves, okay, who's gonna totally change? So I get a call on the ground, and Leah says to me, okay, she's looking for one of us because she wanna know what happened to the program, who changed the program. And I'm like, oh hell. And I knew she was sitting in the bus. So I ducked. I said, Leah, where are you? She said, I'm over by the stage. I ain't going over there. I said, well, I ain't going either. So I ducked back into the tent with the speakers.
I thought you was having one of them nervous breakdowns.
It was a few weeks ago, they released a study that said that women who had girlfriends and spent quality time with their girlfriends were healthier, were much healthier and happier. And I swear, I'm happier now than I have ever been in my life with any man.
When you're doing something no one's ever done before, when you're sort of getting up every day and, if you will, if not breaking barriers, certainly marching atop, it's hard to have an emotional relationship at the same time.
You can find so many fabulous black women in this city and it ain't funny. You know, it's just not funny. I mean, just so many fabulous black women who are doing so well professionally and by their damn selves.
Probably the biggest sacrifice is a relationship, is personal relationship. I'm not saying you can't have everything, but it's difficult.
It's a challenge and a struggle for us, how you find a relationship that's real, that's loving, that is reciprocal, a man who's okay with doing what you do for me. Can you go to church with me? Can you go to the White House with me? Can you go to the hood with me?
Well, I came through that era where there was the expectation that you should want children and you should want to be married, but I wanted just the opposite.
My single malt scotch on a cold wintry night when you come home from work around 7-8 o'clock at night, you just sip that. That is such good stuff. Put the fire on, put on Luther. You don't need nobody in the house with you. The ghost and the angels are always here anyway.
My nephew, we are pretty close. When he was born, my sister was traveling a lot. She sings. I would keep Lorenzo. He'd stay with me. He told me once, I guess when he was about 4 or 5, he said, Auntie Leah, you don't have any children. I said, no, I don't have any children. He said, okay. Then he said, you know what, you don't need any children. I said, I don't. He said, no, I'm all the children you need. And I said, I think you're probably right.
Well, I have two nieces, two beautiful nieces, and one nephew. Yes, I am a professional aunt. Yes, I do probably extraordinary things for them, but that's what you do.
90% of the people who have jobs here, we're their birth mothers. We've given birth to so many damn people, we should have an offering gym after us.
There's a real value in knowing that these women came before you. And in, I'm not saying measure yourself by them, but be inspired by them. Because, my gosh, if they could do it, hard as it was, if they could do it when they were so alone and the face of the kind of opposition that they had, if they can do it, we can do it.
We had our kerfluffles. We disagree about candidates, about politics, about approach to things. But we all have the same sensibility about our people and how we move things forward for our people and how we open doors for the people who are behind us.
We care very passionately about people, about Black people, about the world, and about trying to make a difference.
And I would love to be an influence on making sure that, you know, a lot of people of color have a seat at the table, just like I was afforded that opportunity. And the only way you do it is you have to be in the game.
I want people to see us as whole people. I mean, so many times I think that we as women are so invisible.
Unfortunately, we've not made enough progress. Viewers, critics judge, you know, immediately how a woman looks when in the midst of an interview.
We're the majority of the population. We're the majority of the voters. We're the majority of the workforce. There's no excuse why we're not the majority of elected officials, corporate boards. We need to hurry history. This is a man's world. But it would be nothing, nothing without a woman or a girl.